Erosita, words about the mission which was before Erosita. And the mission which was before Erosita was ROSAT, which you see on the panel. And the ROSAT was built and launched and working 30 years ago. So it took 30 years for us to develop a new X-ray cold sky survey mission. So what you see on the top is the distribution of the diffuser mission as obtained by ROSAT 30 years ago. You see the galactic plane here. In blue, you see the obscured sources. This is the Vela supernova remnant. These are the large and the small Magellanic Cloud. And you see a lot of diffuse emission. For instance, here you see the large polar spur and so on. And you might see these tiny dots. These are point sources. And ROSAT has detected 30 years ago 135,000 X-ray sources after 1 month of scanning the sky. What you see on the bottom is a very fresh image. It was published in June this year. This is the first X-ray old sky survey as obtained with Erosita. Erosita will do this 7 times more. And in this first half year, where the sky was scanned, already 1 million objects have been detected as point sources. So after 7 years, we might expect in total about 10 million X-ray sources with respect to what we have at the moment, which is ROSAT, which has 135,000 sources. It's hard to see, but the Erosita instrument has new detector technology. Now we have CCD detectors, so the images are much sharper. and the energy range is also larger. ROSAT could observe up to 2 kV, while Erosita is going up to 10 kV. So let me spend a few words about ROSAT, as we have this 1 million sources now from Erosita, but the catalog is not published, and publishing a catalog will take 2 or 3 years. So you can expect the first Erosita catalog maybe in 3 or 4 years, if all is working fine with the submission and paper writing and so on. But what we have now at the moment is still are the data from the old ROSAT mission. And in 2016, we have decided to make a new catalog, an improved catalog of ROSAT containing this 135,000 sources. You see here an EITOF projection. In blue, you see the obscured sources here in the galactic plane. In red, these are sources which emit more in the soft, super soft sources. And the size of the symbols scale with the count rate and with the flux. So this catalog is available and is widely used by the community still, and is a reference frame at the moment still for Erosita, where the catalog still has to come. In 2016, we also added more user-friendly parameters and plots to this catalog. For instance, we made for each of these 135,000 X-ray sources, we made an X-ray image, so every user can expect his source as an X-ray image. For every source, we produced X-ray light curves. We made tests if the source is variable according to the standard normal excess variance variability tests, and all this information are in the catalog. In addition to spectral fits, where we have performed a basic power law fit, a black body fit for accreting black holes, and a Mekal fit for the coronal emission of stars. All these parameters are in the catalog and they are still used. And as said, we have to wait 2 or 3 years, and then Erosita will overcome that catalog of ROSAT. I have to say that Hedosita was delayed, or has been delayed for 10 years. The original launch date was 2010, and then it was shifted every year by 1 year. But last year, in 2019, things become more solid, and we had a first launch date scheduled for June 13th. And the day before, this is me and my wife, we were allowed to stand very close to the Proton M rocket. This was the 12th of June, 6:30 Baikonur time. And this was really impressive to stand in front of this Proton M rocket. So I think you get this chance only once in your life. So very impressive. You see here some security guides. Two were watching the mission. And then the next day, we expected the launch. We went back in the evening to our hotel. It's a 1 hour drive from this launch capabilities to the hotel in Baikonur. And the next day, we went in the bus in the morning. And after 2 minutes, it was said, the launch is delayed as one battery is empty. And this is really hard to understand, as such a rocket is monitored permanently, like on a medicine station for difficult patients. So anyway, one battery was empty, and the launch was canceled, and it was shifted then to 1 month later, for the 13th of June. And there it really happened, as you could see, as you have seen on the first picture. So we had 2 days free in Baikonur, and we had a chance, the unique chance, to go through the commando rooms in Baikonur Cosmodrome. And what you see here are the devices in the room where all the Russian space missions were controlled in 1990. And you see that the hardware is really very stable and solid. This was the commando room here. These are the monitors here. You could see here. This is our group visiting. This is Peter Predel, who is the PI of ESO-CETA. And they understood some of the functions, I think, in this control room. We also had the chance to look to some exhibitions there. This is a picture of Yuri Gagarin and Fidel Castro. On the right side, you see a picture of Sigmund Jähn. Sigmund Jähn was the first German cosmonaut who went into space. Unfortunately, 2 months after the launch, Sigmund Jähn died. So we couldn't see the launch of ESO-CETA. We were also able to sit on these control stations. You see, it's quite easy to understand, and you see the layout of the computer and so on. So it was really quite interesting. And all this launch control rooms are underground for security reasons, as if a rocket, Proton M rocket or any other rocket is exploding, you must prevent for failures. Okay, but then we came to July 13th, and ESO-CETA was launched. My wife was there for the launch. I was at MPE, and we were watching the launch in real time. And I tried to show 1 minute of the launch of ESO-CETA. So, it was hit, I was launched. Then it was traveling for 3 months to the L2 orbit. And in October 11th, I had the second science observation in the so-called calibration verification phase. This was a pointed observation with 60,000 seconds, close to 1 day. And on October 11th, I was live in the EROSITA control room, and I could follow how the photons I have proposed. So I have proposed this object, which I'm going to talk about today, 1HO7 -497, a famous active galactic nucleus, observed many times, not understood. I think we have some explanation, which I show at the end. But this was interesting to see how your photons are coming in real time, and I show you some impressions, what was going on during the time where we had a connection to the satellite. So, 2 days later, we had produced the first RGB image of the field of view. And what we found in our data was first a cluster of galaxy, which you see here. This cluster of galaxy has been observed with ASCA in 2000, but it was not spatially resolved. And EROSITA for the first time resolved this cluster. You can see this, the cluster structure of the ISM. You see background AGNs shining through this cluster. So this cluster is analyzed by our colleagues from the cluster working group. And they found already some interesting things with respect to temperature, with respect to ASCM. Our prime target, 1HO7O7, is located here. Normally it should be at the center of the pointing, but it wasn't this. There was some attitude failure. But still we had 1HO7 in the field of view. And as it was not centered, we had a chance also to observe this cluster and to make additional science in this observation. So I will mainly concentrate now on 1HO7, which you see in red. And red means that most of the emission is coming from the soft energy range. What you see also here are the blue sources. And these are sources which are only emitting above 2 kV. I mentioned the ROSAT before. ROSAT could only observe up to 2 kV. So these blue sources are also a new source population, which is now for the first time observed and revealed by EROSITA. These are mainly AGNs, which are highly obscured by gas and dust, and therefore they shine up only above 2 kV, where the absorption coefficient is then becoming lower. So a lot of science can be done, and I concentrate on 1HO7. And we found that. On the top, you see the EROSITA light curve. Here you see the number of counts per second per centimeter square in the detector as a function of time. So this is close to 1 day. And interestingly, we saw that within 1 day, the intensity was going down by a factor of 100. If you want to explain this in terms of stellar emission, you have to switch off 10 billion stars. to explain such a drop in luminosity. Of course, it's not working with stars. It has to do with relativistic effects very close to the black hole. So a factor of 100 is seldom in physics. We know about 5 objects which have a factor of 100. So this was already interesting. What you see in the bottom is the simultaneously obtained light curve with another satellite, XMM-Newton. XMM-Newton was launched in 2000. So this was meant for calibration and effects. And you see that the light curves are more or less. Interestingly, in this light curve, you also see some kind of flaring events and so on. And then the source is really going down to zero. Show it on the next slide in the second. So if the observations would have been started half a day later, maybe we would only have seen the very low state. But we were lucky to have to see the source coming from a bright state going over medium to a low flux state. What is really new and what has been observed for the first time with Erosita in that source is the energy dependence of the light curves. In the top, you see the Erosita light curve, and in blue, you see the total light curve in the energy band between 0.2 and 7 kV. And in red, you see the emission in the ultra soft band between 0.2 and 0.8 kV. And you see that they are more or less identical. So all of the emission is coming from the very, very soft energy band. And if you go to energies above 0.8 kV, which is the green, which are the green points here, so the variability is more or less gone. And this has not been seen before to such an energy range only up to 0.8 kV. There are some objects where the variability drops above 2 kV or 3 kV, but not only going or only existing in the very soft band. And this was puzzling. And we were working for a few months to understand that. And I think we have a solution. For comparison, you see here again the XMM epic PN light curves, which also confirmed the Erosita results. This is the MOS detector on XMM-Newton. And XMM-Newton has also an optical monitor. So the optical monitor is observing simultaneously in the UV. And just we found that the UV emission is more or less constant. Yeah? It has an EV significance of 1.7 sigma. So it's not variable. Whereas in the soft band, we have 40 sigma. Soft band, we have 40 sigma significance that the source is variable. Whereas in the hard band, the significance is only 2 sigma. So this was new. And that is only in the really hard band. I show you here a logarithmic representation of the same thing. And if you look to the Erosita light curve in the top, you see that the total and the soft, so the black and the blue are more or less consistent. And these orange points are the hard energy emission from the solid. And the solid lines are the background, and you see that these hard photons between 2 and 7 kV are running into the background. So to show a slide again on that, this is really important. We made a finer energy spacing. See the light curve between 0.2 and 0.8 kV, which is highly variable as usual. And if you go from 0.8 to 1, it's immediately gone. It's like a delta function. It's not a smooth transition in variability. This has not been observed, to my knowledge, in any other AGN. If you go to higher energies between 1 and 2.3 or 2.3 to 7, the variability is gone. It's only happening in the very, very soft band. So these Erosita photons are ultra soft, and this is similar to galactic supersoft sources. In galactic supersoft sources, we have neutron stars with helium burning on the surface. So these galactic sources can produce such ultra soft light curves. But in AGNs, this is not seen. So it's the first time that we see this ultra-soft behavior. And it's also surprising that we have a sudden drop in variability above 0.8 kV. This is the background. For people who are interested in background, I have to show this slide. As Rosita is in the L2 orbit. L2 orbit is about 1 million kilometers away from the Earth. It's the point where the gravity between Earth and the Sun is zero. So therefore, people and instruments like to go into the L2 orbit. But there was no X-ray mission before in the L2 orbit, and Rosita has taken the first background spectrum in the L2 orbit. This is what you see in red here. So the background in the L2 orbit in principle is lower compared to XMM Newton. XMM Newton is orbiting in the solar system between the Sun and going up to Jupiter. So the background emission is higher in our local planetary system. This background is coming from astrophysical sources, from unresolved AGNs, from unresolved supernova explosions, and from high energy cosmic particles which hit the instrument and make a detector particle. So we know now what the background is in L2 orbit. Coming to the spectra, you see here the energy which is emitted. This is a nu-f-nu plot over energy for various observations on 1HO7. 1HO7 is observed since 2000 with XMM Newton for about 15 times. And in 2008, this is the red curve here, you see that the source was really in a high state. So at all energies, we have a lot of emission, whereas in Rosita, which is in yellow here, the emission is going down, and we have a factor of 10 to 100 differences at a certain energy. So this source is jumping up and down in emission and flux as a function of energy. This was not new, but what we found is that this low state, which you see here in yellow, is the lowest state ever seen for that source, and I come to that in a minute. So how do we model the spectral energy distribution of such a source? Normally you have two components. The first one is a black body component coming from the accretion disk. So it is optically thick matter, and optically thick matter emits a black body spectrum. And this black body, these photons from the accretion disk are going into an optically thin hot corona. They make inverse Compton scattering, and this inverse Compton scattered photons give rise to a reflection spectrum, which you see here above 2 kV. You see here the I and K line, which is the strongest line, but all this is inverse Compton scattering of the primary accretion disk photons. So this is the normal working model which we apply when we try to find a spectral explanation model for the source. For 1HO7, it's a little bit more complicated. This is the spectral energy distribution. This is the spectral fit for the total spectrum. And you see here, if you apply a power law on a black body, the statistics is not good, 2.5. But if you go to a relativistic reflection model, then the fit is much better with 1.2. So this relativistic reflection is coming from the following illustration. You have above the black hole in the accretion disk, the compact corona, optically thin. This corona is emitting a power law emission. These power law photons hit the accretion disk and give rise to a reflection spectrum. So all these reflection lines are not resolved here. As the source was variable, we have divided the spectral fit into three states. In red, you see the fit to the high flux state, in green to the medium flux state, and in blue to the low state. And the model which is working for that source is that we have on the line of sight, we have clouds with a certain covering fraction, and these clouds move along the line of sight to the observer. And if the source is in the high state, the covering fraction, so the fraction the observer sees, is low, only 10%. In the medium state, we found a covering fraction of 32%. And if the source is in the low state, 75% of the emission is blocked by this partial covering fractions. So what we did in this model for the first time, we combined relativistic reflection very close to a black hole with absorption at 10 or 20 RG from the black hole, where the primary emission or the reflected emission is absorbed. This is our working model, the only model which really worked for that source. We have here the black hole, and at the distance of 1.3 RG, we find this compact corona. And so this is very close to the black hole, so we're working here in the strong gravity regime. And this corona is emitting power law photons. Some of these power law photons are lost in the black hole due to light bending, but some of these photons reach the accretion disk, ionize the disk, and giving rise to a reflection spectrum. And this reflection spectrum you see here in red. And this light has to pass these clouds, which are moving in this direction with a velocity of 0.2c. And then independence, how large the covering fraction is, we have a low state and a high state. So this is our physical model, which explains why we have a high state, a low state, and a medium state. It does not, it also explains why we see this ultrasoft light curve. And this took us 3 months to find that out. So why can the light curve so ultra soft that we only see emission in the soft band up to 0.8 kV and not in the hard? And the point is, if you ionize these absorbing clouds, then up to 1 kV, they are more transparent than soft X-rays, as most of the elements are completely ionized. So the absorption coefficient is low. And up to 1 kV, we have a complete transparency for the photons coming from the disk. So if we ionize disk, if we ionize this absorbing clouds, then they are more transparent of X-rays than neutral absorbers, and they show leakage effects in the soft X-ray, explaining the ultrasoft light curve. And this is understandable, this makes sense. And this explains why the light curve is ultra soft. And if you put an ionized absorber to the line of sight, the soft band is not much affected by absorption, whereas above 1 kV, this effect is gone. So the point is ionized absorber play a role. Let me show you this also again. These are the observations from 2000 up to 2020. I proposed this source in 2000 for the first time. You see the fluxes in the soft band in blue and in the hard band, and you see that the source is highly variable in flux. The data points here are the data points from this 2019 observations, and you see that the hard emission is really in a historical low state. So 1H7 was never observed in such a very low flux state. So it's the first time that we see this in this low flux state. If you go to the last data points, these are the observations from April 2020, where 1H7 was observed in the first ESO-CETA Old Sky survey, and then the flux has recovered. So the source has changed within half a year. Immediately it's flux and it's going back to normal states. This is illustrated again here. You see here in the light curves in red from the PV observations in 2019. In blue, this is the hard band. And On the right side, you see the observations in the all-sky service. Then you see the red points are going up, the blue points are going up. This statistics is, of course, not so good in the survey, as we have only here 240 seconds, and here we had 60,000 seconds. So one of the last slides is that one, and this is a plot showing what is going on in the UV. This is the UV luminosity. The UV luminosity mainly tells you what is the emission from the accretion disk. And this is the X-ray luminosity. And normally in black, this is the distribution for broadline Cepheid-1 galaxies. If you increase the UV luminosity, the X-ray luminosity is also increasing. In red, we have a comparison sample of Netherline Cepheid-1 galaxies. 1HO7 is a Netherline Cepheid-1 galaxy. And our flux state in the X-rays is here. There's a factor of 100 to 1000 lower compared to that, what you normally expect, even in Netherline Cepheid-1 galaxies. On the other hand, the UV luminosity is huge. It's 10 to 44 arc per seconds. This is the Eddington limit. If you apply bolometric corrections, you even get 10 to 45 arc per seconds. So that means the source is accreting 10 times Eddington. So the UV luminosity is extreme and is stable over years. It's also stable in our observations and stable over years. But the X-rays are extremely dim. And we think that this absorption by ionized partial covering clouds are in agreement with that plot, what we found in the LX LUV plane. So to summarize, we found a drop by a factor of 100 in one day, which is rare and good. What is new is, it has not been seen so far in active galactic nuclei, is that the photons are ultra soft. So above 0.8 kV, the source suddenly drops close to the background level, similar to these galactic supersoft sources, and this is unusual for AGNs. The flaring and the fast decline below 0.8 kV is surprising, as not been seen in other AGNs before. The partial cover with relativistic reflection explains the unique X-ray softness. The relativistic effects of the primary corona emission is very close to the black hole at the 1.3 RG, so very close to the black hole. The strong UV emission ionizes the surrounding material. So this UV emission is ionizing our partial cover clouds, that they are ionized, and then they can show leakage effects in the soft band and make the light curve ultra soft. A change in covering fraction of this ionized absorber explain the strong X-ray variability and also the ultra soft light curve. We could constrain where the absorbing material is located. And we found it's very close to the black hole, about only 10 RG. And there the orbital velocity is 0.2 C. And the size of the absorber is 10 to 13 centimeters or 2,500 light seconds. So we can determine the size and the velocity of this ionized partial coverer for the first time. And I think that's interesting. Analysis and comparison with 20 years of XMM-Newton observation revealed that 1HO7 entered the most extreme low hard flux state first detected in the simultaneous ESO-CETA XMM-Newton observations. So this is, again, the first half year scanning of the ESO-CETA all-sky survey. You see a lot of sources. I was talking about this source here in galactic coordinate. It's located here. This is 1HO7. This is the talk I have given. And you see many other things. Here's the LMC, here's the Vela supernova remnant, here's SCO X1, the brightest source in the X-ray sky. Here you have Cygnus X2, Perseus cluster and so on. And all the sources are now under investigation by the ESO-CETA consortium and along with this the science from 1HO7, which we have submitted last week as the first science paper of ESO-CETA. This is the first submission of science paper with ESO-CETA data. The referee has received the paper on Monday. Maybe he was listening, and I don't know. But we are working on all these other nice sources, very nicely resolved spatially and spectrally. And I think there are a lot of science outcomes to come in the next years from ESO-CETA. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Thomas, for your very nice talk and to share with us and let us participate in your personal impressions from the beginning of your talk. So let's come to questions. I have a question of Jana Martins to you. Nice results, Professor Boller. I'm curious about the causes of this variability. It is an intrinsic behavior of the AGN or could be an environmental effect?
In our case, we think it's an environmental effect. So it's correct that you can also have variability if you change the scale height of this corona. And you can also have factors of 100, but we didn't find that the scale height is changing within one day or is too short within one day. So our interpretation is that we have this partial covering clouds moving on the long of sides. So it's an environmental effect. That's the answer to this question.
Okay, a second question. Has any difference been observed in the fraction of covering absorbers and the type of AGNs, example FR1 or FR2?
The covering fractions have not been determined very precisely at the moment for AGNs. I think we did it for the first time quite precisely, but the determination of covering fractions is really at the beginning. So we do not have a large database, at least to my knowledge. What are the covering fractions? We have 70%, 30%, 10%, and so on, which we found. I know that there's an ESO-CETA project who will build up a database of covering fraction for different types of AGNs. But to my knowledge, this is really at the beginning, and I think we found some reasonable values. What is the covering fraction? What is the distance? What is the velocity?
Okay, there are no more questions. Thank you very much for this very nice talk, which opens a new window to look in a new range of maybe new physics also.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.